I try to hold on to this world with everything I have, but I feel the weight of what it brings and the hurt that tries to grab. The many trials that seem to never end. His word declares this truth, that we will enter in this rest with wonders anew. But I hold on to this hope and the promise that he brings, that there will be a place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, and no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. But until that day, we'll hold on to you always. I know the journey seems so long. You feel you're walking on your own, and there has never been a step, but you've walked out all alone. Troubled soul, don't lose your heart, 'cause joy and peace he brings, and the beauty that's in store outweighs the hurt of life's sting. But I hold on to this hope and the promise that he brings, that there will be a place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, and no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. But I'm
praises. One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and
morning, everyone. Good morning. Great to see all of you here this morning. And I don't know about all of you, but maybe it's because I'm nervous, but it already feels a little muggy in here. So our bulletins have multi-uses this morning. They can be a fan. So I want to talk with you for a minute about VBS. And you saw me up here a couple weeks ago talking about VBS, and it is quickly approaching. And first and foremost, I would ask you to be praying for VBS and our staff, the children that will be attending, the needs that we have, and et cetera. Today, I have a clipboard, and one of the things on this clipboard is a prayer list. So this can help to direct you as you pray for VBS. So please take one of these prayer lists, put it in your Bible, put it on your bathroom mirror. That's where I put things I need to pray about. And your refrigerator, wherever it is, that will remind you to be praying for VBS. VBS is in 2 weeks. Like, whoa. It's coming quick. We have some needs. We have some needs for craft supplies, and we have some needs for snack supplies because, well, these kids like to eat. We all like to have a good snack at VBS. So on this clipboard are lists of things we need. And we're going to send this around this morning. If you could sign up for some things that you would be willing to help provide for Vacation Bible School, and then we'll know what things that we need to purchase. So there's a craft list on here, and there's a snack list, and there's a prayer list. So please take the prayer list, add your name where you feel you can help. The other piece that I am looking for some help with is I would like to have a room for the VBS staff to step into, grab a quick drink, a little snack. If you would be willing to, first of all, if someone else would like to coordinate that, I would love that to pieces. But if you're willing to help provide a snack for in that room one of the nights, that would be really great. And so on the bottom of the craft page, just because that's where there was space, it says staff room something, snacks or something. And so if you're willing to help with that, just add your name and I'll be in touch with you. And like I said, if you're willing to spearhead that piece for me, see me after the service. Also, VBS staff, you should have received an email from me. If you did not receive an email, please see me after church. That means that I do not have your email address, okay? So please see me. Also, I don't know what the also was. It just went out of my head, so. Okay. Yes. Next Sunday morning before church, we will have a VBS staff meeting at 9:30. And so all VBS staff that can, please be here for that. We'll meet downstairs. And then the following Sunday will be the day before VBS starts. And so we will need some people after the potluck to help with setup and decorating. And I think that's it. If you did not sign up to help with VBS and you're like, well, this sounds like a lot of fun, I want to be a part of this, it's not too late. I can put you to work, so come and see me. So this clipboard will be going around. When it gets to the back, if someone could just set it on the back table, that would be great. And if you are signed up to volunteer in VBS, could you stand up? Everybody stand up that is volunteering in VBS. So look around. These are people who I need you to be praying for, because we are going to be teaching children about the armor of God. They need the armor of God in today's world. We all do. But we need to teach our children about the armor of God, and that's what we're going to be doing. And we know that in the next 2 weeks and in the week of VBS, Satan is going to be attacking because he doesn't want our children to be equipped. So look at these people and pray for them, please. Thank you, everyone. Stand up to worship, please.
Good morning, everybody. So just for the record, she said it's not too late right now to volunteer or, you know, help out. I'm pretty sure that Monday, if you just show up and have not talked to her at all, she will have something for you to do. I promise. So on that note, I'd like to pray, and then we can all get into our worship time together. Dear Lord, I thank you. Thank you for this day that we've been able to come here together and congregate in your name. And I even thank you for this muggy weather where it's what we got. And just pray that you'd help us to use this as an opportunity to practice patience with each other as we're all rubbing elbows in here today. And pray that you'd help us to have a good time of fellowship together, a good time of worshiping you, and that you would give us all attentive ears once the speaker comes up. In Jesus' name, amen.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love.
And the men voices, and there's probably a technical term for what that is. I don't know what it is, but it just sounds so good, and I know the Lord just hears that, and he must just think, wow, that's great. Speaking of things that are awesome, we're going to sing about our awesome God next.
When he rolls up his sleeves, he ain't just putting on the Ritz. Our God is an awesome God. There's thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fists. Our God is an awesome God. The Lord wasn't joking when he kicked him out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very close, and so you better be believing that our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above. In the void of the night, our God is an awesome God. He spoke into the darkness and created the light. Our God
awesome God. The judgment and wrath he poured out on Sodom. Mercy and grace he gave us at the cross. I hope that we have not too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom. Our God, our God is an awesome God. Written on his heart, I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. Hallelujah! My life is found in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, for I am his and he is mine. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Righteousness, God's perfect Son, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die. My soul is purchased with his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior. My Savior and my God. Hallelujah! My life is found in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah! For I am his and he is mine. I bow before the cross of Christ, marvel at his love divine. God's perfect Son was sacrificed to make me righteous in God's eyes. This river's depths I cannot know, but I can glory in its flood. The Lord Most High has bowed down low and poured on glorious love, and poured on me his glorious love.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you. Thank you again for giving us this place to come together in your name. And I thank you for this music that you've given us to worship you with. And just thank you for this next song especially. We get to sing, Great Are You, Lord. And I just pray that you'd help the message of this song to sit in our hearts as we sing it, that would be lifting these words to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
All the earth will shine. Father, your love is truly unmeasurable. We cannot fathom just how much you love us. You provide this place, our lives, our breath, our lungs, your love, our love, your faithfulness, our adoration. You provide all that. Without you, O God, we are hopeless and helpless. But with you, O God, we are worth more than can be imagined. And that's all because of you, Jesus, for loving us so much. Thank you, O God. Amen and amen. Good morning, everyone. Today we have Richard Grindle coming to join us. Once again, if you've heard him speak with us before, you've been blessed. Today you will be blessed again. He works for an organization that we could support in a powerful way, and some could even be a part of. He'll explain all that, I'm sure. But as our family, I'd like to welcome him, Richard Grindle, to come on up and share with us all about the Gideons. And you've got a lot to look forward to. Amen. Well, would the little ones please come on up?
I'm sorry, Dick. We're going to do the church.
Yeah.
That's all right, Mr. DeRaps. As I have mentioned before when I've been here, Mr. DeRaps came to the same hometown I came from, and because he was living there and I was an officer there for 40 years. But it wasn't because of that the connection that we know each other. But I was involved in the schools a lot, so. And I now call him Mr. DeRaps. Okay, it's great to be here. It's always great to be here. It's been 2-3 years, but I love to come. You folks are so friendly, so welcoming, and it's great. But I'm also very thankful that my wife Kay got to come with me. Another fellow Gideon, Tim Russell, has come to pray for me and to be with us. We also have the Hugheses, you know them. They're involved in the Gideon ministry also, so that's great. And it's great. I recognize some faces from before, and like I say, it's always good to be here. I want to thank Pastor Reese and your committees or whatever to allow us to come to present a report of the Gideons International. It is our primary goal to win boys and girls, men and women, to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And I know that's your same goal also. It says that in Matthew 28:19 and 20, go ye. That's me, you, everybody. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. What a promise that is. What a promise that is. Last year, by God's grace and by his enabling, approximately 276,000 Gideons and auxiliary around the world in 200 countries have given out the word of God. I can report that somewhere between 60 and 65 million Bibles were given out worldwide last year. That's like placing a New Testament in a child's hand or a motel Bible in a hotel 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, at the tune of 2.5 testaments per second. There is much more need, there is much more want than that. I'm here to report that motels and hotel Bibles, because when I reported before, they were $5. Inflation, whatever. To place a book, a Bible in the hotels and motels now costs us $6.50 per Bible. It's still around $1.25 or $1.30 that we can place a New Testament in hands. We have color-coded. We have orange ones for grade 5 through grade 12, so in the public schools or private schools. We have green ones, and sometimes the green ones have a design like this one has in the front that we place in colleges. And I will just say that every year we go to the University of Maine in Orono, and there's approximately 10,000 students there, but we give out approximately 2,000 Bibles every year up there. So that is where some of the finances that we ask for go. We also have white New Testaments that go to nurses and go to medical staff in the hospital facilities, in doctor's offices, dentist offices. And then we have auxiliaries. The auxiliary testaments that go into facilities in place, and my wife will mention that a little bit later. My wife is actually going to speak a little bit this morning. And we also have facility Bibles for jails. We also have a program where one of the Gideons in New Hampshire actually takes used hotel Bibles and takes the hard covers off and puts a soft cover on, because you cannot send a hard-covered Bible into a prison. So it has to have soft covers. So we do that ourselves as a state association. Our state association is Maine, New Hampshire, and Vermont together. We also give to firefighters, law enforcement, EMS. And we also have, and I don't have with me, I apologize for that, a larger size, larger print Bible for places like nursing homes, hospitals, where it's easier for them to read. I also want to tell you that we give out Bibles at fairs. And one of our fairs, or the fair that we do in our camp, is the Skowhegan Fair. I don't know if anybody has ever seen our display when you've gone through, but we've had a couple years in the past where we've given out 600 or 700, but usually the average of 400, just a few over during the 10 days. And we'll be doing that again this year. But I just wanted to tell you, last year, it's nice to see fruit. One of our Gideons, Nelson Sturdivan, who's now a member in Virginia because he's moved there, he led a 15-year-old to the Lord at our booth. His grandmother and grandfather brought him. They went to, and I assume still go, to the Second Baptist Church in Waterville. But their grandson was ripe for the Word of God, and he was led to a personal relationship with Christ. My wife and I were up there last year, and we had this woman walk up to us and says, "Thank you, Gideons, for what you do." I can't remember, Kay, 30 years ago, 35 years ago, her mother went to a motel in Biddeford to end her life. She picked up a Gideon Bible. She opened it. She read in it. Decided not to do what she was going to do. Took the Bible home. Eventually became a child of God. And this lady that came to us says, "My mother's in heaven, but because of her decision that day, way back years ago, and my decision since, I know I'm going to see her again. thank you for what you guys do. You know, we don't hear all the testimonies, but we hear a lot. And it's an old saying, if but only one, it was worth it all. Isaiah 55:11 is sort of like a theme verse or title verse for the Gideons. And I'm going to read it a little slow because I want you to listen to the personal pronouns. Isaiah 55:11, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return void, but it shall accomplish that which I please. And it shall prosper in the thing whereto I send it. What a promise! We don't have to worry about anything. What a promise. God's word is going to do that. That's why we love being in the, I'll use the word, the business, in the ministry of giving out God's word. Because just giving it out can lead to salvation. Another way to supply Bibles, and you have a display out back of Gideon cards, where you can send a card for recognition, for thinking of you, praying for you, in memory, and you can send a check to buy the Bible to the Gideons. But you can send that card to someone that's in need of hearing from you. I also want to say that I am sure that the Bibles and New Testaments are desperately needed in the third world countries. You see, there's only 5 to 8 countries in the world that can pay and supply their own Bibles. It's the good old United States that is helping these and other nations get the Bibles delivered to them and even have a hand giving them out. I said we have 200 countries. 5 to 8 that can afford their own is not a very high percentage. And you know, there's always orders, there's always wants for more Bibles. They can't be sent out until the financing comes in to get them out. But I always like to hear testimonies. And Brad, you have a testimony that he's going to show us about 10 minutes long, and then I'll come back. I should say this was at the Gideon's Convention last year, live.
Thank you. What a joy and a privilege it is to stand before you. This room is filled with my heroes. That's right. Gideons are my heroes. Now, I know that for many, athletes and actors and movie stars are their heroes. But for me, Gideons are my heroes, and let me tell you why. I'm sure most of you know exactly where you were on September 11th, what we call 9/11, when the Twin Towers were attacked in New York City. I know exactly where I was. I was on my college campus. I had just graduated high school and began my college journey, and I remember standing there and watching the big screen as the towers were hit. And I remember it doing something to my heart. And I called my mom and I said, Mom, I'm going to sign up for the military and I'm going to go to war. And my mom said what every mom in this room would say. She said, no, you're not. I said, yes, I have decided I'm going to sign up for the Marine Corps. I'd never thought which branch of service. I just knew that they were the first to fight, and I liked their uniforms. And so that's what I did. I signed up for the Marine Corps. I went down to Parris Island and very quickly was wondering what in the world did I get myself into. But after graduating boot camp and getting in the Corps, I became a machine gunner in the Marine Corps. And I was put into a what they call a MAP platoon, a mobile assault platoon. What that simply means is that we didn't have a base. We were our own base. We were a mobile base. And so we could go anywhere and train to do anything. which I was in the Marine Corps at a very dangerous time and served in a very dangerous place in Fallujah. You remember the fighting that was going on there. It was very dangerous at the time. It was so dangerous that where we were, that many times they would just airdrop us our food. They couldn't bring it out because it was too dangerous for them to get to where we were. Matter of fact, I saw a chaplain one time who was brave enough to come where we were, and his vehicle got hit by improvised explosive device, and we never saw chaplains again. We were in a very dangerous place. But I'll never forget when I boarded the bus to head to the transport for the plane that I was going to get on to go overseas to fight in Iraq. I'll never forget that as I boarded that bus, there was a man standing, leaning up on the bus with a cane, and he was an older man, and he was handing out testaments. He was handing out these little Bibles, and I got one myself, and I thought, well, that's neat. That's pretty cool right there. Loved the size and loved the color. It matched our uniforms, and I thought something other was interesting. It fit perfectly right inside of my left breast pocket of my uniform. So I took that testament and I just placed it there in my left breast pocket as a good luck token, and maybe that it would bring me great success and bring me back home. And so I just placed it there, didn't think I would ever have a chance or an opportunity to read it. Well, as I told you, I was in a very dangerous place. They told us before we left that everyone wouldn't come home. And hearing those words, most people would not want to go if you knew that your chances of coming home were very slim. But I'll just be honest with you. I never thought it would be me. I never thought that I would get hurt. I never thought that I would get injured. I really thought that I would be just fine. But it did happen to me. In August of 2006, I was shot in the chest by a sniper, 7.62 armor round to the chest. If there's any military families or men in this room, you're thinking to yourself, you are a miracle. And ladies and gentlemen, I am a miracle. I'll never forget when I was shot in the chest and I was laying there in the sands of Iraq. I remember all I could do was look up, and I begged God right there that he would spare my life. I didn't ask him to spare my life because I was afraid to die. I asked him to spare my life because I knew I wasn't ready to stand before God. I knew I needed to get some things in order. I knew I just wasn't ready. They were unable to get me air support, to get me to any kind of medical care because of the sandstorms that were of that day. So they had to ground medevac me, which took a lot of time, and it was a long process to get me there. I'll never forget when they began to work on me, when they finally got me to Fallujah Hospital. I remember that one of the officers said, "This man's a miracle." Because I had, even though I had sustained the injuries to my chest, I had no internal bleeding. The Lord had certainly heard my prayer. I was there in Fallujah Hospital. When you think about a hospital, you're thinking of a room with a TV and air condition. That's not the hospital that I was in. I was pretty much in a makeshift tent. Didn't have any visitors, didn't have no TV, didn't have no telephone. I was there all alone. And I'll never forget that one of my Marines, he came and visited me. Now, you got to understand something. We were a mobile assault platoon. We didn't go back to base. We didn't work from base. We were our own base. The only time we got to go to the base was if we got injured, we got killed, or our vehicles got hit by an explosive device and it needed to get repairs. One of my Marines, his vehicle got hit by a roadside bomb and he was coming back in to get vehicle repairs. Well, he knew that I was there and he would have a few days there, and so he was a good old country boy from Murfreesboro, Tennessee, and so he bought a good old watermelon off of a Iraqi, and he knew that he was going to see me, and he wanted to put a smile on my face. And I don't know about you, if you're in any kind of hot weather, all it takes to put a smile on your face is a good old watermelon with a little bit of salt. Amen. All the country people in here know exactly what I'm talking about. And he did. He came walking in with that watermelon, grinning ear to ear. I'll never forget his words to me. He said, "Man, you are so lucky to be alive." And I said, "You're right, buddy. I sure am." We had a good time. We ate that watermelon together. He walked out of that room, and that's the last time I was ever able to see him. 1 week later, he was shot by a sniper and killed instantly in Iraq. And I'll just be honest with you, my heart was broken. I entered into the lowest point of my life. Again, I'm in a hospital room with no one to talk to, no one there, in isolation, injured. My fellow Marines are out fighting, getting hurt, injured, and dying, and I can do nothing about it. I was in the lowest point of my life. At that point, I had never experienced depression. But I had come to the lowest of lows where I didn't care if I lived or if I died. Not only was I in a pit of depression, I was in a pit of sin. My life was not being lived in the way that it should have been lived. I was in a pit of depression, in a pit of sin. And at that moment, I remember that little Testament Bible that I had. Only thing in my room was my uniform sitting next to me. And I thought to myself, I wonder if that testament is there. And I reached over to where my uniform was, and I reached into my left breast pocket, and there it was. I know many times people wonder why these little Gideon testaments have the Psalms and the Proverbs in it. And it doesn't have all the Old Testament, it just has all the New Testament and the Psalms and Proverbs. Well, I'm here to tell you the reason why it's got Psalms in there is because of me. I opened that Bible and I began to reading. I didn't have anything else to do. I was at the lowest point of my life, and I came to the book of Psalms in chapter 40, and I read about a man named David who was in a pit of depression, in a pit that he couldn't get out of. He was not only in a pit of depression, but he was in a pit of sin. And I started reading in Psalms chapter 40, verse 1 through 3, and he said, "I waited patiently for the Lord, and he heard my cry, and he brought me up out of the pit, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon a rock, and he established my steps. He put a new song in my heart. Praise be to God." Many people will see it in fear and will trust in the Lord. And I just thought, Lord, if you can do that for David, surely you can do it for me. And right there in the room, Jesus changed my life forever. I'm sure that there's some Gideons and pastors in this room that maybe you're thinking, Lord, am I doing enough? Am I truly making a difference? Let me tell you something. I am living proof. That old man who was standing next to that bus that day, handing out those Bibles, he may have thought to himself, am I really making a difference? Yes, you are. I may never meet that man again, this side of glory, but I can tell you something, the testament changed my life. And I'm telling you, this world is in great need. I don't have to tell you that. This world is in trouble, and it's in great need. We don't need another president. We don't need another politician. We don't need another person. All we need is the Word of God. That's what this world needs. So you need to keep on going on like you've never gone before. Give like you've never given. Serve like you've never served. Pray like you've never prayed. God is going to use you. Listen, the Marine Corps gave me a Purple Heart, but thanks be to God, He gave me a brand new heart. Thank you.
Dynamic speaker, isn't he? All, if only just one, it's worth it all. It's worth it for him. It's worth it for the one that failed last year. It's all worth it. I'm going to ask, as you leave today, there is a offering plate or a basket out back for donations to the Gideons. You can put in cash. If If you make a checkout, make it out to Gideon's International. And just thank God that every penny that comes into the Gideon's goes for the publishing, the delivery, and the purchase of the Bibles. That's it. You see, we pay dues. The auxiliary pay dues every year. The dues is what runs the ministry. The offerings buy the Bibles. Gideons also have the opportunity to travel to different countries at their own expense, to go on a special blitz. We've had people from Maine go on special blitzes. They usually go for 2 weeks. We had one from the Bangor camp that went to Mexico here the last five years ago for 2 weeks. They weren't very busy. They gave out 1.2 million Bibles hand to hand in that 2 week period, 24 of them. And if only one, but we pray for more than that. So to God be the glory for all that. I would like to say that you can become involved in the Gideon ministry. If you're a professional business person, it's like any ministry, we ask for three things. Prayer. Pray for our ministry. I know you do. Secondly, we invite you to give, which I've already done. But thirdly, we invite men to consider becoming involved in the ministry. It gives you unlimited opportunities to pray, to witness, and to give out Bibles. You see, Gideons, we are men of the book. We are men of prayer. We are men of faith. We are men of a separated walk. We are men that have compassionate hearts. We are men who witness, and we are men who give. So if you'd consider wanting to be involved in the Gideon ministry, I'd ask that you talk to me afterwards, talk to Tim, talk to Ron. The ministry is always in need of new members. And our wives are extremely an important part of our ministry. Extremely. And I won't get into what Kay's going to say in a moment here, but they do pray for all of us Gideons. And again, to God be the glory. We ask God to God be the glory for the simple reason that all he has done and he wants to do and continue to do for us. So I invite you to partner with us. Pray, give, and join. Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. I'm going to ask Kay if she'd come forward, and she's going to share a testimony, a personal testimony, and also tell you what the Gideon's auxiliary function is.
Greetings. To God be the glory for all he does in all of our lives every day. What a blessing to be a member of the auxiliary. We first and foremost are asked to pray. We pray for pastors and their wives and families and churches. Our camp has a list, and you folks are on that list, and we pray for you.
We pray for our Gideon husbands as they travel and speak, for our families. Secondly, we distribute God's word. We ladies give out medical testaments to medical personnel in hospitals, nursing homes, school nurses' offices. We also give out facilities testaments to crisis resource pregnancy centers, prisons, homeless shelters. We also have testaments that we use to witness. And our third command is to witness, is to be a witness for the Lord, and to remember that verse in Job that says, there are yet words to be spoken on God's behalf. One of my sisters retired from serving the Lord as a missionary in Africa for 45 years. When she returned home with her 12 duffel bags, I thought I should fly to Florida and be a friendly face and welcome her and help her get settled in. She had a place at Africa Inland Mission Retirement Center in Florida. So I was there for a couple weeks to help her acclimate, and I needed to fly home on a Friday. So Thursday, we called the airport for a shuttle, about an hour from Orlando Airport to where she lived. The shuttle drove in the yard about 2:30 in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, and it had no words on it. And when we opened the door, there was no light and a man I didn't know. And I have to admit, I was a bit nervous. So about 5 minutes into the trip, I said to him, and he was obviously of retirement age, do you always drive at night? And he said, well, he said, see, my wife and I lived in the Pittsburgh area. We had four children. She was a history teacher. I worked in the steel factory. And we made plans that when we retired, we would sell our home and move to Florida and buy a place there in an easier life, and we wanted to travel. I wanted to take my wife, of course, to Hawaii and other places, but I don't suppose you've ever been to Maine, he said, but my most favorite place to take my beloved Betty, he said, is to Maine. He said, when I was 8 until I was 18, my grandfather rented a cottage in Rangeley Lake, and I have such good memories, and I wanted to take my Betty back there, he said. But he said, we didn't plan on her having cancer and needing treatments and prescriptions that my retirement didn't cover. So he said, I drive at night because then I can take her to appointments, get groceries, take care of the home, and see to things at home. And he shared a few more heartaches of the family. And about 5 minutes before the airport arrival, I said, sir, may I say a prayer for you and your dear wife, Betty, and your family? He said, please do. So I did. And I asked the Lord to bless them and bless Betty. And so we pulled up in front of the terminal, and he took out his wallet and removed a business card. And he turned to me and said, ma'am, I don't know if you send cards, but he said, when my Betty gets sad and depressed and discouraged, he said, I don't know what to say to her. He said, you know, I can take care of her. I can get the meals and do the laundry and take her to appointments. But he said, when she has such a sad heart, I don't know what to say to her. I wonder if you would send her cards of encouragement now and then. I said, I would be honored to do that, of course. So when we got out of the van and went around to the back to get my luggage, I handed him a New Testament, and I said, sir, far more comforting are the words of Jesus Christ in our Bible. And I said, in the front, there are specific references you can read when you're discouraged, when you're lonely, when you're sad, when you're depressed. And I said, the verses in the Bible that are written in the front. I said, you might want to read them to Betty. And I said, when you're waiting at doctor's offices, I said, and waiting for her appointments, I say, may I suggest you start reading the book of John? So we parted our ways, and I came home and wrote cards to Betty, and our ladies' Sunday school class did as well. And about 2 months later, Betty called, and because I had written my address and phone number, and she said, thank you for giving John that New Testament. She said, he's been reading it, and she said, she said, when we moved to Florida, all my life, she said, I've gone to church alone. When we moved to Florida, I found a good church, and when I was no longer able to drive, my neighbor would take me to church. And she said, yesterday was Sunday, and we got up, and John said, I'm going to take you to church today. She says, the first time ever. To God be the glory. And so I kept writing cards, and about 6 weeks later, she called again and said, yesterday, John accepted Christ as his Savior. I know where I'm going, and I know where he's going, and we will be together for eternity. And she was so thankful for the blessings of God's word that pierce the heart and reveal one's need of a Savior. And then we were away, but John left a message on our house telephone that his dear Betty had passed away. But he knew where he was going, and he knew he would see her again. To God be the glory for his faithful word. And I have three takeaways from that. First of all, I believe God needed a lady that day to minister to John and to Betty. And I was privileged and honored, and I give God the glory for being that person that day to help John. Secondly, I believe that our connections with Maine, by the way, I forgot a really important part. Whenever we parted ways at the van and I had given him this, I shook his hand. I said, I'm going home to Maine today. And he just gave me the biggest bear hug, and he had tears in his eyes. And secondly, I believe God gave us a special connection. He designed that a lady from Maine would be there for John. Thirdly, I believe there are John Garlands all around us who need God's word and need a special touch of the Holy Spirit. Thank you.
You can hear from the testimonies a Bible in the hand placed under the authority of God and containing God's word can lead to salvation and a saved soul going to heaven. So as we ask for donations today, remember your donation may be the one that's needed at the right time, the right place, with the right intention to be placed in a hand that will lead to glory for some individual lives. Thank you for allowing us to come in. We'll fellowship a little bit afterwards. Renee, thank you.
So Craig's over there watching me tear up twice. You know what? Thank you, Lord. Amazing, amazing stuff, right? The word of God is truly the most powerful thing. Those of you who've heard my testimony know that it has to do with a Bible just like that. So, Father God, thank you for loving on us so much, providing this time together to get together, to be with our brothers and sisters in Christ. We are in like mind. knowing that our salvation comes through you and you alone, Jesus. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for opening up our eyes to that. And Father, I'm going to pray that if anybody is here now that needs to know that their salvation is secure through you, Jesus, that you can give them that eternal perspective in knowing that they will be with you forever. I pray, Father, today's the day that they stand up and they ask. They ask you into their lives. And if it's me that you use to help lead them, please let them see. Come and see me. Come and see any of the elders here. Come and see Rick, Richard Grindel. Because we are all about your love. Amen. Amen. Go to God. Go with God throughout the week, and praises be to you, O Lord. Amen. Amen.
In my own little world, it hardly ever rains. I've never gone hungry, always felt safe. I got some money in my pocket, shoes on my feet. In my own little world, population, me. I try to stay awake during Sunday morning church. I throw a 20 in the plate, but I never give till it hurts. Turn off the news when I don't like what I see. Yeah, it's easy to do when it's population me. What if there's a bigger picture? What if I'm missing out? What if there's a greater purpose? I could be living right now. At a red light, looked out my window. I saw cardboard signs that held this homeless widow. And just above that sign was the face of a human. I thought to myself, God, what have I been doing?